And then we go prepare the next presentation that will be given by Pablo Fernández.
So first of all, good evening to everyone. It's for me a pleasure to have the opportunity to share the results of my research here at this symposium. My name is Pablo Fernández. I'm a PhD student at Universitat Politécnica de Catalunya, also known as UPC. I'm working within the research group of construction engineering, and I'm currently supervised by Professor Antonio Marí and Professor Eboyer. I would like to also thank them for all their help that they have given me throughout all these years. And after this short introduction, I'm going to start with my presentation about the effects of unidirectional tensile stresses on the punching shear strength of reinforced concrete slabs. Why this line of research? I would like to start my presentation explaining why are we researching on this topic. Since 2015, our university is involved in a coordinated research with other four Spanish universities, whose main goal is the lifetime extension of reinforced concrete structures through an adequate structural assessment and strengthening. Before the beginning of this coordinate project, our research group was working on the development of mechanical models, mainly for shear and punching shear of reinforced and pre-stressed concrete structures and since 2000. And we have keep doing that since now. Well, we are also in close contact with real-life designers, and in one of those meetings, some designers told us pointed out that this topic was an insufficiently studied phenomenon that may take place mainly in breaches and floor slab. So we, at that moment, we had to decide what was going to be the topic of my thesis, and we decided to start studying this phenomenon. Where do concentrated forces and pain tensile stresses act simultaneously? Well, mainly in two situations. In continuous box girder breaches, at intermediate supports, where hoisting bending moments tensile stresses arise in the top slab due to hoisting bending moments and may act together with the heavy vehicle concentrated load. The other common situation is in floor slab subjected to lateral loads due to earth pressure or wind mainly. This skew compression going from the loaded side to the restraining columns of the opposite side may create some tensile stresses in the plane of the slab that may act together with the reaction of the columns, creating this situation. Also, in post deformation, such as shrinkage or thermal strains, may provoke the arising of membrane forces, but this would be the case of biaxial tension rather than uniaxial tension. Regarding the previous work on this topic, this phenomenon has been barely studied throughout the years. In the early 80s, there were two experimental campaigns at Cornell University in US in the context of a research for the US Nuclear Regulatory Commission. And they tested almost 40 reinforced concrete slabs subjected to biaxial tension and a concentrated load. In that period of time, Paul Regan, a well-known researcher in the topic of shear and punching, presented the results of three reinforced concrete slabs subjected to unidirectional in-plane tensile stresses and out-of-plane concentrated load. But as can be seen in the picture here, only one of them can be considered a two-way slab. Finally, and more recently, Wu et al. From the University of Lyon in France studied the influence of the uniaxial tension on the shear strength of reinforced concrete slabs with concentrated load placed close to supports. So, summarizing, there is a scarce research on this topic, and experimental tests are needed to improve our knowledge in this field. We decided to tackle this phenomenon from three different points of view, three different approaches. The first one, an experimental campaign with two main objectives: identify and quantify the effects of unidirectional in-pain tensile stresses, tensile forces on the punching strength of reinforcement to the slab, and provide experimental results to contribute to the theoretical model extension and validation. The second approach is that theoretical model. I mean, the extension of the punching shear stress mechanical model already developed at UPC in close collaboration with the University of Balearic Islands to the case of in-pain tensile forces. This model will be validated with the experimental results from the campaign. And finally, the third approach is the generation of a finite element model capable of reproducing the test of experimental campaign to allow us also to run simulation with different values of tension from those applied at the laboratory, just to have a wider view of the phenomenon. Now I'm going to briefly describe each one of these three approaches, and afterwards I will present the obtained results altogether. Well, the specimens of the experimental campaign. Five 165 centimeter squares and 120 centimeter thick slabs were cast and built at the laboratory. Four of them have 12 millimeter diameter bars parallel to external tension, whilst the remaining slab, called type B, had 16 millimeter diameter bars parallel to external tension. The reinforcement ratio was the same for both types of slabs in the direction perpendicular to the external force. This ratio was about 1.3%, whereas the reinforcement ratio in the direction parallel to the tensile force was 1.1% in type A slabs and 2% in type B slabs. All these slabs were supported on 8 axis symmetric supports with a 1.5 meter span. The specimen had 10 25 millimeter bars partially embedded on the slab, 5 bars on each side, to connect the slab to the tensioning system, which is described in the next slide. To cause the punching of the slab, a 145 centimeter square steel plate was used on it and was placed on the center of the slabs. The mean material properties are listed in the slide. The average compressive concrete strength was 37 megapascals with an average tensile strength of 3.3 megapascals. In this slide, I wanted to show the tensioning system. It consisted of an auxiliary steel frame, the yellow one you can see here in the picture, surrounding the slab. On one of the faces, a passive anchor for the tensioning bars was used, whilst bars were stretched from the other end with the help of hollow jacks, as the one you can see here in this picture. An important point that I want to highlight is that the value of the external force applied on each test is measured in relation to the tensile force producing the cracking of the slab cross section, the so-called thick crack. As we can see here, it is equal to the area of the concrete cross section times the tensile strength of the concrete. In this table shows the different values of the tensile force applied in each test. We had one control slab without tensile force, and then the four remaining slabs were subjected to different levels of tension. Here I just wanted to show some picture of the final setup. Here in the top left, you can see the support schema. eight load cells placed in a circle, trying to reproduce axisymmetric supporting conditions. Here in the top right, you can see the main hydraulic jack of the laboratory used to apply the punching load to the slab. And in the bottom part of the slide, you can see the connection between the protruding bars of the slab and the bars station that allow to use the hollow jacks to apply tension. And here there is a perspective of the of a slab ready for testing. Now I'm going to talk about the second approach, which is the extension of a previously developed mechanical model for shear and punching. Firstly, I'm going to briefly describe the main assumptions of the model, and then I will explain how we extended it to impact tensile forces. Well, the compression core capacity model is a mechanical model that was initially developed to estimate the shear strength of reinforced concrete beams subjected to point of distributed loads. For a specimen without shear reinforcement, which is the case, which is our case, the model considers only three shear resisting actions, which are the shear resisted in the uncracked head, the shear transferred across the web cracks, and the shear resisted by the longitudinal reinforcement thanks to double effect. One of the main points of this model is that it considers that the main resisting action is the shear resisted in the uncracked head. So the other two resisting actions are grouped with the shear resisted in the uncracked head in just one resisting action, a so-called concrete contribution. The main equations are derived from the equilibrium of forces in the free body that you can see here in the bottom left of the slide. And also the failure criterion for the model is the Kapfer failure envelope. We say that when one point of the uncracked head at the critical section, which is placed at the point where the diagonal crack reaches the neutral axis, when one point of that critical section reaches the Kapfer envelopes, the ultimate shear load is reached, and the beam reaches its maximum capacity. Well, this model was extended to punching, taking into account the main differences between shear and punching. Basically, two main differences. The first one is the position of the contour perimeter. It is considered to be at an average distance of 0.5 times the effective depth of the slab. This is due to the shape of the radial bending moment law, which is different in a slab than in reinforced concrete beams, and also because of the stress concentration here in the slab column connection, which converts this region into a D region. So this is one of the first assumptions. The second assumption, and also main difference between punching and concrete and shear, is that the concrete compression head is confined by tangential and vertical stresses in the vicinity of the column. This phenomenon is included in the model by modifying the failure criterion of the Kapfer failures envelope. What we do is to change the tensile the compression concrete strength for the confined concrete compression strength, which allow the concrete to resist more shear. We, for the sake of simplicity, we use the expression given by the Eurocode 2 for the confined concrete compression strength, and incorporating them into the equation and solving the equations again, and the equilibrium equation of the free body is shown here, which is the portion of the slab enclosed by the critical crack and the section where the crack reaches the tension side of the slab. Once you solve this equation, you obtain this expression in here. I would like to highlight that the punching strength of the slab can be greater than the flexural punching failure rod. This flexural punching failure rod is the load that produces the yielding of the deformations at the control perimeter. This is in reality a flexural failure, but the slab breaks on punching. That's why it is called flexural punching failure. This expression here is derived from the Timoshenko elastic theory of plates, considering that the radial moments per unit length is equal to the slab yielding moment per unit length at the control perimeter, making the assumption that the Poisson ratio is equal to 0.3 and a particular ratio between the radius of the column and the position of the point of zero bending of zero radial bending moment, you can write this expression here. Well, finally, the punching model was extended to in-plane tensile forces. After a parametric study, an expression for the neutral axis depth in presence of a tensile force was derived and used in the model. You can see the expression over here where x0 means the neutral axis depth in pure bending. As you can see, it decreases as the tensile force applied to the slab increases. The other main assumption is that the position of the control perimeter is considered fixed and not affected by the external tension. Of course, the angle of inclination of the cracks may be affected by tensile stresses, but since the slab column connection is at the region, it has been considered that it hardly affects the position of the control perimeter and has not been taken into account in the proposed model for the sake of simplicity. Well, the procedure is similar to the other cases. The equilibrium of forces is set in the free body enclosed by the diagonal crack and the section where that crack reaches the tensile side of the slab. And with the same failure criteria of the modified Kapfer envelopes, solving this equation, we get to this expression over here for the punching strength of a slab subjected to tensile stresses. Okay, our case of study was uniaxial tension. One of all assumptions of during our study was that in the uniaxial tension case, half of the perimeter is subjected to tensile stresses, whilst the other half of the perimeter is not subjected to any kind of stress. So to find out the punching strength on the uniaxial case, we sum the half of the punching strength without tension and half of the punching strength with tension, resulting in this expression over here. Finally, the last assumption of this modified model is that when the external tension applied is greater than what we call T crack, the tensile force that provokes the cracking of the cross section, the tensile force is considered to be resisted only by the reinforcement. What happens with this? Well, it turns out that the capacity of the reinforcements decreases suddenly, decreases in an amount equal to the total tensile force divided by the total area of reinforcement. And this may lead to a change in the failure mode because the flexural punching failure load now is lower because the value of the steel strength have decreased and may prevail over the punching strength of the slab subjected to tensile stresses. This is a condition that has to be checked in design. The third approach was the finite element modeling. The model was built using ABAQUS software, ABAQUS Explicit, which is very useful with highly nonlinear problems. As there was double symmetry, only one quarter of the slab was simulated. Just summarizing a little bit, for the concrete, 8 nodes cubic elements with reduced integration were used, and with 20 millimeter size, which means that there were 6 elements in the thickness of the slab. And for the reinforcement, 2 nodes linear beam element were used. The material models were for the steel and elastic plastic model with perfect plasticity, and for concrete, the concrete damage plasticity was selected. For the constitutive equation of concrete, the Hogmestad parabola was selecting compression, whilst the Model Code 2010 tension stiffening model was selected for the tension stiffening. The main parameters of the concrete damage plasticity are here in the slide. I'm not going to enter into detail, but they came from a parametric study, mainly the angle of the dilation, and the other ones are default values that can be found in literature. I would like to highlight two important aspects of the simulation. The first one is that the slab were support on nonlinear springs with a very high stiffness in compression and a very low stiffness in tension, which allows the uplifting of the slab in the area of the supports. And the other one is the way the tensile force was introduced into the model. The tensile force was applied directly to a set of node places where the anchoring plates of the tensioning bars were located in the laboratory specimens. I know that the picture is small, but here you can see highlighted in red the nodes that where the tension was applied, and here the blue lines are the cracks produced by that tension. Well, now I'm going to talk about the obtained results. This slide shows the comparison of the results obtained with the three approaches. As can be seen in the table, both the mechanical model and the numerical simulations predicted very well the ultimate loads obtained in the laboratory test. The plot shows the relative loss of strength. I want to highlight that the relative loss of strength with respect to the control slab. As can be seen in the graph, all the three approaches yielded similar results, with a linear decreasing trend of the punching strength accentuated when the external force applied was bigger than T-crack. This comparison has been made for type A slabs. I remember that type A slabs had 12 millimeter diameter bars parallel to the external force. Since there was no control slab for a type B slab, the numerical model after calibration was used to simulate the type B control slab, so we can calculate the relative loss of strength to that particular slab. As can be seen, the relative loss of strength of the B slab, which is this square here in the plot, fits very well the curves for the type A slabs. The reason why is explained later. In this slide, I just wanted to show that the good agreement between the numerical model and the experimental and the laboratory test, both in the low deflection curves and in the cracking pattern. Here we can see how the cracking pattern changes from, in the numerical model, a perfect cycle, let's say, with the radial cracks and some critical tangential cracks, to a more, let's say, flexural cracking pattern for the case of the tension applied equals to 1.26 times the crack. As can be seen in the pictures, also the cracking pattern changes due to the tensile force applied. One of the main conclusions of this research is that the external tensile force may change the failure mode from punching to flexural punching. As explained before, if T is greater than T crack, if the tensile force is greater than T crack, concrete cracks and the tensile force is resisted only by the reinforcement. So the flexural strength decreases and the flexural punching strength may prevail over the punching strength. If the amount of reinforcement parallel to external tension is not enough, flexural punching failure occurs, and that's why the slope of this line increases after T equals T cracks. On the other hand, if the amount of reinforcement is enough, the failure mode remains the same. And that's why the slope for the type B slabs remains constant because the failure mode doesn't change. Another important aspect is that for values of the external force lower than T-crack, the relative loss of strength with respect to the case without tension is similar regardless the amount of reinforcement parallel to external force. That's why the stresses in the reinforcement when the tension applied is low are not very big, and the behavior of the slab remains the same. I mean, of course, if you increase the amount of reinforcement, you are going to have a greater punching strength, but the relative loss of strength is similar independent of the amount of reinforcement. Well, just to conclude, our model, the compression core capacity model, was validated with the test results available in literature. Most of them are the Cornell's test with the axial tension. As we can see here in this plot, the tests with the uniaxial tension are very scarce, and more tests are needed just to validate this model. But the model predicts the ultimate load very accurately with a mean ratio of 1.13 and a coefficient of variation of 9.32%. Well, and just to conclude, I'm finishing my presentation, and I'm going to read the main conclusion of our study, which are punching strength decreases with increasing external and pain tension. This decrement is accentuated for values of external tension greater than T-crack. And the relationship between punching strength and external tension may be approximated by a very bilinear function. For low values of T divided by T-crack, increasing the amount of reinforcement parallel to external force does not have a favorable effect in terms, as I said before, of relative loss of strength with respect to the T equals to zero case. For values of the tensile force applied greater than T-crack, concrete procession cracks and all the external tension is transferred to reinforcement, which may yield with an increasing concentrated load prior to punching failure, changing the failure mode to flexural punching failure, thus reducing the punching strength. Increasing the amount of reinforcement avoids this effect. And finally, the proposed model predicts accurately the ultimate load of the punching shear tension test available in literature. And very few uniaxial tension tests have been carried out, and future research on this topic is needed. And well, thank you to everyone, and thank you for your attention, professors.
Thank you, Pablo. Unfortunately, we have very little time for maybe one question.
Bruno Godard, it's not a question. It's just a mention, because this is an excellent presentation, is that there is, since we are under the FIB symposium, there is an excellent bulletin from FIB, which is number 81, on punching shear of structural concrete slabs. And I didn't see this bulletin of FIB in your references. So do you know it? Or if not, I recommend to read it.
Okay, thank you, Professor. I didn't know that. And of course, I will find a copy of that bulletin, and I will have a look at it.
Yeah. Thank you, Bruno. There is one question here now from Andri Satyawan. Thank you very much, Pablo, for the interesting presentation. My question is that, did you observe different failure mode, crack patterns, or crack inclination for slabs with TU over T crack less than one, and for that ratio larger than one?
Yeah. We observed in the load deflection curves that for values greater than for values of the tensile force applied greater than T-crack, the slab experimented a ductile behavior prior to failure. You know, there was a flat part of the slab at the end of the test, which means that there is some kind of ductility which is related to this we call the flexural punching failure. For the other cases where the tensile force applied was lower than T crack, the failure mode was clearly punching and it was a brittle failure.
Okay, thank you very much.